Let me ask you one step sideways for a second before we get to the political intrigue. This Axios report that they took a look at a subpoena that supposedly was given to a witness who's going to go before Mueller, and it was asking people to preserve all of their electronic communications from about 2015 with this long list of Trump people. You are on that list in terms of people they want communications captured with. What do you make of that subpoena?
Well, I think it's probably standard protocol for the Mueller investigation to see if there was any collusion or cooperation or coordination, which we know there wasn't. But what they want to do is they want to look and see any communication between staffers that potentially they would be interested in. And my guess is this is information that the Mueller team would already have access to. I am sure, and the campaign has been very clear about this, they have cooperated with the Mueller investigation in any way, shape, or form, and any electronic communication between potential individuals that were associated with the campaign that were done on the campaign communication network would have been preserved already, and I'm sure the Mueller investigative team already has those.
When you say we know, you, of course, are open to the idea that we don't know, right? We only know what Mueller's able to show in the end. I mean, you've said in the past you can't know about all the different things that Mueller's looking at. You weren't privy to all these different communications. You weren't part of all the different dynamics that have been exposed already. So you're not 100% sure of that, are you?
Well, I'm only sure of what I am familiar with as it relates to Corey Lewandowski, and I know that I didn't coordinate or cooperate or
but there are a lot of other people at play. You're only one on a very long list of people they're looking at.
You're exactly right, Chris. You're exactly right. And what I've said and what I mean, and I've been very clear about this, if anybody attempted to influence our U.S. election system by coordinating or cooperating with an outside source to materially change the outcome of this election, those people should be in jail for the rest of their lives. And if that's what Bob Mueller finds, is that people were trying to do that, we've seen they've indicted 13 Russians. If they have found individuals who are trying to impact the outcome of an election from the U.S. here, those people need to go to jail. Our democracy is too sacred.
All right, next point. 22 folks, staffers, talked to the Washington Post, say it's crazy in here in the White House. It's hard, it's dysfunctional, we're having a hard time, our morale is down, we can't get things done. What do you say?
Well, look, I love the sources that aren't willing to go on the record, and I think if people want to complain about their jobs, and let me tell you this, I don't work in the White House, I've never worked in the White House, but it is an extremely difficult environment under any circumstances. And if you go back and you talk to our friends who've worked there in the past, regardless of the administration, the 18 hours a day, 7 days a week, constant barrage is very difficult. But look, it is an amazing privilege, I think, to be able to serve our country by working in the White House. And if people don't want to work there, they should leave. Because this job, being the administration, is bigger than any one staff person. And if you don't think that you're in the right position, do yourself and the president and the country the service that they deserve and leave, and not go out, you know, on the record or on background with 22 sources who say it's chaos. If you don't like it, you can leave. It's a free country, still do that.
Right, but why not look at it the other way and think about what the culture is in there and who is engendering that culture, and maybe that should be addressed. Maybe chaos isn't a great working theory for the business of government. Maybe there is something to what is being talked about by Scaramucci and others, that the chief of staff has created a culture in there that is making a lot of people feel down in the mouth. You think there could be something to that?
Well, what I think is, you know, if I look back in the last year, it wasn't that long ago where everyone says that White House was in chaos because the Reince Priebus, Steve Bannon, Jared Kushner triumvirate at the top, and no one could understand who the boss was. No one's saying they don't know who the boss is anymore. They know that John Kelly is the chief of the staff, and he's running the staff in that way. But what I don't understand is, you know, there was chaos 7 months ago when it was a freewheeling. Everybody had access to the White House, to the president, and now it's chaos because everything is controlled and buttoned up, and there's a process. So I don't think you can have it both ways. Do I think that people say, hey, I want it one way or the other, or maybe you're somewhere in between? Possibly, but you can't make the argument on both sides. And I think what you've seen here is that John Kelly has put in process a process in place where people have to report through a specific line. And I know some people don't like that.
Do you think that if he pulls, well, he did pull Kushner's security clearance, do you see that as an indication that he and maybe the president's daughter may not be long for the West Wing?
You know, I don't see that. I think Jared and Ivanka will have the opportunity to stay inside the West Wing for as long as they want to. Let me say this. You know, when you look back at a number of people who didn't have their access to a top secret security clearance, there is a rationale for understanding that there has to be a process in place to make sure that people should have access to the right type of clearances for our own country. And we saw a problem in the White House a few months back where an individual who shouldn't have been there continued to have access to information, and that was a failure somewhere.
Who are you talking about?
I think Jared Ivanka will have...
You're talking about Rob Porter.
Clearly.
Do you think Kelly knew about that?
That's exactly right. No, I don't know. I mean, I don't know.
How do they not
know,
Corey?
Just think from what they told me.
Yeah, but think about, you know, if you were there, you know, you worked on the campaign. You know about accountability at the top. You know the FBI knew this. You knew they were delivering information to the counsel's office. How do you not know?
Well, Chris, I think somebody
knew. Like somebody said he had traffic tickets.
No, Chris, somebody knew. Somebody knew, and the question was, what did they know and how soon did they know it? But look,
but
don't
then, so how are we supposed to take it, Corey? Because this is a big part that gets us into this fugazi fake news and the media is so bad BS spin that'll come out of the White House. You know, somebody knew. You just said it yourself. And we all know that that's the truth. This isn't the kind of information nobody pays attention to. Gossip is like 50% of the job down there in terms of learning about who you're working with and their vulnerabilities. So we say, well, obviously somebody knew. So let's get after it and figure out who was it. Was it Kelly? Was it this one? Did Hope Hicks? Should she have been involved with it? You know, does this go all the way to the president? And those questions all get attacked as being unfair. But isn't all of that scrutiny totally legitimate when you have someone this close to the president handling all the things that the president is going to have to sign off on? Weren't those all legitimate questions?
No, there's some clear legitimacy to those questions. And if you look at what the House Oversight Committee is now doing, is they're investigating the administration to understand how that process broke down and why it failed. And that's the right thing to do right now. So Trey Gowdy has asked very clearly for an understanding of what the process was, who knew what, when, and where. And I think he's going to get to the bottom of it. And that's a very fair thing for him to do to make sure that the people who need and are required to have access to top secret information have that with the best of their ability and the best understanding possible. And I think that's what the House is going to look into.
If the president were to say to you, Corey, I think I'm going to let Jared just see this stuff. I'm going to show him my briefing every day anyway. I don't care what they say. I trust him. What would you advise him?
Well, the president has 100% authority.
I know, but what would you advise him? It's not about having the right to do it. It's about whether or not it would be right to do it. What would you tell him?
Chris, what I think is the access of information that the president has and who he can grant that to is very selective. And if he wants to grant access to someone so they can look at something specific, so in their particular role in the building, they should have the opportunity to do that. And what we know, part of Mr. Kushner's role is negotiating Middle East peace. And if there's information that he needs to have access to in order to continue in that capacity, then and the president feels comfortable giving that to him so that he can help achieve that goal, then he should be have the opportunity to do it. But that is completely at the discretion of the president in a limited basis. And that I know of, and the president's very clear, he gave John Kelly, the chief of staff, the ability to decide what was going to happen on the clearances. And John Kelly has made that decision.
Under the category of chaos, we look at these tariffs. I understand, you understand what Trump's disposition is in terms of muscling up and then falling back on a position. But tariffs are a very dangerous thing to do that with. And that's why he really took people by surprise the way he came out of this. This isn't what his advisors wanted. People were telling him it isn't the intelligent way to do this. You got to let us get people on board with it. He blew all that away and just went out with it. And now he's going to have to try to negotiate his process through Twitter. Was this the right move?
Well, I think, Chris, if you go back and you look at the campaign, which is now almost 2 years ago, he'd been talking about the need for tariffs for a long time. So, you know, the reports that the staff wasn't aware of it, I think are somewhat untrue. There was a report listed just today that, you know, a few weeks ago there was a meeting in the Oval Office between five or six people who discussed this opportunity and whether or not to impose tariffs. So this notion that the staff hadn't been aware of it, I think, is factually inaccurate. But what I do think is very important is this president has said, if this is going to help Americans have more jobs, meaning we're going to have manufacturing here in the country, that's a pledge he made during the campaign.
Right.
And now that he's fulfilling that promise, should not be a surprise to anybody.
Right, but how's he fulfilling the promise with tariffs? See, that's the point. You want to cut new trade deals, go ahead. Tariff is not a deal. It opens you up to retaliation. We've never seen it work in the past. Now he's going at Canada and Mexico. No one's saying that this goal is a bad goal, to have more jobs. It's whether or not this is the right method. To the name of your book, Let Trump Be Trump. Yeah, when Trump is doing something that's good for everybody else, you think this is an example of where he should have listened to his advisors?
Well, I think he did listen to some of the advisors. I think he listened to Wilbur Ross. I think he listened to Peter Navarro. And what they said was the section that of the U.S. code, which the president is using, right. Section 232, from what I understand, is a national security issue. And the president's position has been, if we don't have a steel industry and we don't have an aluminum industry here in the United States, it presents a national security problem. God forbid we ever have a serious conflict. And that's where he's doing this under. Now, does that give us the opportunity to go back? And what he tweeted today was, let's go back and renegotiate NAFTA so that it can be fair to the United States. That's a fair thing. And let's just look at it for 1 second. The tariff that he's talking about, particularly as it relates to aluminum, is a cost of, and the New York Times wrote this story, so this isn't the right-wing propaganda. It's 1 cent on every beer can that you're going to drink. So you buy a six-pack of beer, it costs you 6 cents more, if and only if they use 100% of the domestic aluminum available. If they continue to use recycled aluminum, right, which is about 80% of what a beer can is made of, it's a half of 1 cent on a can. So are U.S. citizens willing to pay 3 cents more for a six-pack of beer to create aluminum manufacturing jobs in the U.S.? I think the answer is yes.
Well, but that's not the metric. The metric will be, how does the market respond? How do your trade partners respond? And what does that do in terms of putting pressure on U.S. labor? We'll have to see how it plays out if it actually happens. Corey Lewandowski, appreciate you taking the opportunity. Appreciate your perspective.
Thank you, Chris.